Hi, everybody. Welcome to Cloud Cover. Today, I've got a very special guest, Art K from Sencha. Art, would you like to tell everybody a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, sure. So I work for Sencha on a professional services team. I'm based outside of Chicago, and my job role with Sencha is to go out with our customers and help them build applications, do training, fix bugs, pretty much do everything under the sun.
Okay.
In some cases, they get to build some really cool software projects like the one we're here to talk about today.
Great. So I've heard of Sencha before, but can you kind of tell us what Sencha does overall? Like, what is Sencha?
Sure. So Sencha is a technology company that focuses on building tools for creating applications based on web standards. So many developers will choose to use Sencha's products because we have a full stack of complementary technologies that help to deliver business applications quickly and easily. And if you look at the screen, we've got a number of products and services that Sencha offers. Mm-hmm. We are most well known for XJS and Sencha Touch, which are our HTML5 software development frameworks.
Okay, that's actually what I'm familiar with. I've played a little bit with Sencha Touch, so okay. I'm looking forward to hearing about the other stuff. So go on.
Beyond just our development frameworks, we also have development and deployment tools to help facilitate taking those applications off, you know, to the cloud or to wherever you're deploying your application. So things like Sencha Space, Sencha Architect, Sencha Animator, and Sencha Command. Mm-hmm. I'm actually going to showcase very quickly Sencha Architect in just a little bit.
Okay, great.
And then last but not least, we offer first-class training and support on our products, as well as obviously professional services.
Great. So I think, you know, this is Cloud Cover. Mm-hmm. We'd love to see, you know, what is Sencha going to do and how do we do it with Azure?
Sure. Yeah. So just real quick, the end result of using Sencha's technologies is simply that you can get an application onto virtually any device that runs a web browser.
Okay.
And so in the case of mobile apps, like we're here to talk about today, you can even wrap those applications using Apache Cordova or Adobe PhoneGap.
Okay.
And the package that we're really here to discuss is how to take Sencha Touch and connect that to a Windows Azure backend. Mm-hmm. So as an HTML5 development framework, our frameworks are backend agnostic. So you can connect to Azure, you can connect to .NET in the backend or PHP or whatever it might be.
Anything you might want.
And you don't have to change any of the client-side code. So the EXT Azure package is a connector between your Sencha Touch application directly into your Windows Azure mobile services or storage services.
Okay.
So I'm going to dive into some examples in just a second. Quickly, if you wanted to download our package, you can go to market.sencha.com and download the zip file. Or if you're using Sencha Command, you can run Sencha package get for the Touch Azure package, and it will automatically download and install for you.
Great.
So quickly, let me jump into our documentation. And I'm going to start on the Windows Azure website, where if you go to the mobile services section where they have all their tutorials and resources, mm-hmm. you can see that we've already put up a getting started guide for using Sencha Touch. And so this is a fully functioning application that you build from start to finish mm-hmm. in exactly the same way that you would for any of the HTML or Windows Phone or iOS examples.
So if you've walked through that to-do list, it's going to be, you know, pretty familiar. Just this is how you do it with Sencha.
Exactly.
Great.
So we have that on the Windows Azure site for the developers in the Windows community. But since we're developing that strategic partnership between Windows and Sencha, we're also going to have full API documentation, user guides, and examples on the Sencha mm-hmm. documentation. So if you go to docs.sencha.com, you're going to see we have the full API for the EXT Azure package, everything from, you know, a basic explanation of how to set up the EXT Azure package inside of a Sencha Touch application, to things like your configuration options, what methods are available to you in the API, as well as a variety of events that may get fired during the application lifecycle. And at the end of going through those guides, what you end up seeing is an application that looks something like this. This is just a simple to-do list where we can have a variety of items marked with checkboxes as to whether or not those to-do items are complete.
Mm-hmm.
You can click the X to delete them from the list. You can add new items in the the input field at the bottom. Mm-hmm. You can do filtering and all sorts of things that come out of the box with Windows Azure.
Right. And it looks like, you know, you can tell that this is not just the very basic, just a to-do list. Like, there's added functionality here. This is the ability to page in because you can load more. Mm-hmm. You can actually delete items. You can filter. It's a little more than just the simple to-do list you get when you start out.
Correct. So the first thing I wanted to do was to take Sencha Architect and build a very simple list of the items I have in my Azure table. Mm-hmm. So what I'm going to do is open up Sencha Architect. And it's important to note that you don't have to use Sencha Architect to build a Sencha app. If you're more comfortable staying with, you know, Visual Studio or Eclipse or the IDE of your choice, you're free to do so. Sencha Architect just has a bunch of other utilities built into it. Mm-hmm. So if you want to do things like theme your application, work with user extensions, a variety of other new features that we've added, it makes the learning curve to our framework just that much easier.
So it's going to be a little bit easier for me to use this than how I typically code, which is a notepad.
Exactly.
Okay,
exactly.
That makes sense.
So in Sencha Architect, I'm going to create a new Sencha Touch application and just create a blank project. And so open up the Architect interface. And what we see here is a blank canvas for an application. So Sencha Architect is really a visual tool to help build your application. And we can have all sorts of classes from the Sencha Touch framework over here on the right. Since I'm using the EXT Azure package, the first thing I may want to look for is to see that I have the Touch Azure package installed, which is here under extensions in my toolbox. And we can see the couple of classes that I do have in place.
Mm-hmm.
So the first thing I'm going to want to do is to drag my Azure controller into my project inspector. So you can see that Sencha Touch is an MVC style framework. So if I could actually get that to drop on the node.
There we go.
What the Azure controller will do will be to automatically initialize EXT Azure when the application launches. So we don't have to do any magic.
All right, nice.
The next thing we're going to want to do is to click on our application node and physically construct the initialization options that we need to connect to Windows Azure.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to create this object called Azure. I'm going to make sure it's of type object. And then I'm going to start to edit. And in my case, I want to have an app key and an app URL. Where we get these is in the Windows Azure Mobile Services portal. So if I click on Mobile Services, I find my mobile service. I can scroll down. I can see my mobile service URL.
Mm-hmm.
I copy and paste the bit after the HTTPS. So Sencha Azure To Do.AzureMobile.net.
Yep.
Oh, sorry. That's the it's my URL.
Yeah. There we go.
And for the app key, I simply pop open the manage keys. It's going to give me my application key. Drop that there. And that's all the initialization I really need to do to get my Sencha Touch application to start communicating with Windows Azure.
So the Azure controller is going to automatically use that Azure object just to use those settings.
Exactly.
Great.
So the next thing we're going to want to do is to actually have a view as an interface to the data that will be returned from Windows Azure.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just going to create a simple list in my toolbox. I'll drag that over to my views. And what we're going to end up doing is attaching a data store to the list so that the data store can communicate with Windows Azure, get the list of records, mm-hmm. and display them in the list. So we'll come back to our Touch Azure package. Take my Azure store, drop that over. Drop that over here. And what we'll see is that the Azure store is an extension of an EXT data store that just has a proxy that's automatically defined.
Mm-hmm.
This proxy comes with a table name that we're going to need to change so we can tell which of the tables in our mobile service we want to pull data
sure.
from. So find the table name, and it defaults to my Azure data table, but I'm going to want to pop back into my Azure portal and figure out what the name of my table is. In this case, it's to-do item.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll change that down here. You can see that that's updated in my code over here.
Mm-hmm.
The next thing I want to do is to create a data model so that I know what the data is going to look like when it comes back. So I'll take a model, drag that over here. And let's say I want to call this, rather than my model, since we're thinking about to-do items,
mm-hmm.
let's call it a to-do class. And I'm just going to add some simple fields here. These fields should probably match what's defined in our table in Windows Azure. If I were to open up my table, I can see some things like an ID, text, whether it's complete, and what time it was created at.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, since we're keeping this pretty simple, I'm just going to stick with ID and text. You can see that these fields are now attached to my model. On my data store, I simply want to assign that model. And last but not least, what I want to do in my application is when the application launches, I actually want to load the data store the first thing.
Okay. Now, is that actually going to say, hey, go get the data from the server?
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. So the data store won't automatically load its data. You can set a configuration to have it do so.
Mm-hmm.
But in our case, I need to make sure that we initialize the ext Azure package prior to trying to load the data store.
Sure.
So what I want to do is to look for my launch method. Come over here. I need to figure out what the name of my data store is. Let's give this has my Azure store as a store ID. So I can simply say ext.getStore. Load. So now when the application launches, it will automatically go and do that.
Okay.
The final bit is to actually style our list so that it has something relevant from the data coming out of the data store.
Mm-hmm.
So it defaults to list item. This is just a vanilla bit of templated HTML. Maybe we can just get rid of all that, and we'll just say text hyphen, and then we'll put an ID. This is shorthand for the EXTX templates.
Mm-hmm.
Each of these bits inside of the curly braces match to the fields that are on our data model.
Gotcha.
So now, if I were to save this project, we'll call this Azure I'll start going into my web browser. And I have this running on a local host. See if I can't find the folder I just saved this in. So I saved it under Azure. And if I have done everything correctly, and live coding never goes smoothly.
Never.
An unexpected token somewhere. So I need to clear this. I believe I need to refresh my Sencha command. So what Sencha command is doing, it's going through my application files looking for any resources it needs to compile before putting it up on the web.
Mm-hmm.
So now that it's done that, I should be able to come back here. And we'll see nothing on the screen. So what's actually here is my list.
Mm-hmm.
If I look at my network tab, I did see a call go out to Windows Azure that came back with some items, and I think I forgot to assign the store to my list. There we go. So save that. So the problem was there's a list there, but it doesn't know where any of the data is.
Okay, now we see.
So now here we go. So you can see within 5 minutes, I've already built a Sencha Touch application connecting to Windows Azure. This is really very, very easy.
And then we could basically take this Sencha application and wrap it in anything and run it on as a native application on a device.
Exactly, yes, yes. So it's a good segue into some of the other features that the EXT Azure package ships with out of the box.
Mm-hmm.
So not only do we connect to the data tables in mobile services, we also implement the authorization through Twitter, Facebook, Google, and Microsoft,
mm-hmm.
As well as push notifications.
Okay.
So let me give you a brief demo of the authentication piece. Here we have another application that looks very similar to the one that we just built.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've got a toolbar at the top and something to add items at the bottom. But this list doesn't have anything in here yet because I haven't actually loaded it. Oh, shouldn't. So now if I want to log in through, let's say, Twitter, it'll launch an OAuth redirection
mm-hmm.
because I've already logged in. It then redirects back to the application and will load any of the data that comes out of my Azure data table. This is very, very easy to set up. When you look at our documentation for authentication, what you end up doing when you create that Azure object on your EXT application after your app key and app URL, we have this bit for auth identities.
Mm-hmm.
So once you've gone into your mobile service and you've gone to the identities tab to set up any of your Facebook, Twitter, Microsoft, or Google settings,
mm-hmm.
Once you've done that, then in the client-side application, we can say which of these auth identities we've set up,
mm-hmm.
and that will help the EXT Azure interface display some of these options here in our pop-up.
So is that UI right there going to be built for you when
yes.
you put that in there?
Oh, yes.
Great.
Yeah, so this is very, very seamless. If you wanted to style this or do it differently, you have the API to do it manually.
Great.
But this view comes out of the box.
Okay, that's great.
So now with push notifications, one of the things that you have to keep in mind is that push notifications currently are only supported on natively wrapped apps. So if you've taken your Sencha Touch app, you can have that app run in the web, but push notifications won't come through the app when it's running in the browser.
Right.
So we've taken one of the PhoneGap plugins for push notifications and ported that to use the connection through Windows Azure. So again, what you'll have to do in your mobile service is to set up any of your credentials under the push tab.
Mm-hmm.
In my case, I'm going to demo something coming through Apple, so I've uploaded my developer certificate.
Mm-hmm.
And then looking at our push notification API, after my app key and app URL, I've added another object called pushConfig. And so what you physically have to do is to take any channel name, sender ID from either Microsoft or Google for their platforms,
mm-hmm.
or in the case of iOS, the PhoneGap plugin handles this for us.
Mm-hmm.
And that configuration will automatically get initialized when the application starts, and then allow you to start receiving notifications from the platforms you've set up in your Windows Azure portal.
Great, that sounds a lot easier than actually doing most of the setup yourself.
Yeah, yes. So as just an example, you can see here that I've got that same to-do item list.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got that running here on my iPad. And if I simply type in a new to-do item, the request will go out to Windows Azure. This is taking its time. So it finally popped open. Now we can see that I've got a push notification here on my iPad.
Okay. And from the mobile service side, this is no different from if you were developing a native application. You're just doing a push to, in this case, APNS. But it's all the client side, and it's just that because you're able to use the PhoneGap library and Sencha, mm-hmm. it's a lot easier to do on the client side.
Exactly. And so one of the other things that our library does, for push notifications, you get a series of events. So when you first register your application with the PhoneGap plugin, you have an event that tells you whether or not that registration happened successfully. Mm-hmm. And then you can also get notifications, or you can also fire events when notifications come in. So in my case, I'm popping open some sort of pop-up in my application, but you could also easily add badges to the app icon. You can wake the iPad from sleep. You know, anything that you can normally do with push notifications, you can do through the event system in the EXD Azure package.
Great. Okay.
So the last piece of the EXD Azure connector to Windows Azure is the idea of either a blob or table storage through the Azure Storage Services. Mm-hmm. And I don't currently have an example to show, but the idea here is very much the same as what we've put in place for the mobile services. The only difference being that with mobile services, you have an app key and an app URL. Mm-hmm. And with storage services, it doesn't work exactly the same way. So you have an account name and an access key. And in your Sencha Touch application, we've allowed you to start creating either blob or table objects that have those configurations set up like so. You have an account name and an access key that can store it into, in this case, a blob object. Mm-hmm. And if you wanted to then push a new blob up to your storage service, you can go down to, let's say, maybe a put block. So you can put a block blob mm-hmm. onto my blob storage account. And you can see what the configuration options look like for this API. It's really very, very simple to do. And it's a great way to not only store things in Windows Azure, but if you wanted to, let's say have private videos or private pictures, rather than having a direct URL link, you can physically call the Azure Storage API, pull out the raw binary, and then display that in your application. So you don't have to worry about making the URLs public, because our API can connect to those private bits of your storage account.
Okay, so basically just making it really easy to either put stuff into or pull stuff out of blob and table storage from your Sencha application.
Exactly.
Great, that's really nice to see.
Yeah. So again, the EXT Azure package is out there right now. You can download it from the Sencha Market or through Sencha Command. And we hope that everyone in the Windows community finds Sencha Touch that much more useful for creating mobile applications.
Absolutely, and like you said, this works across, so we've made a website here, it runs a web, but you mm-hmm. also can push it down to your iPad or a Windows phone or an Android device, works across them all pretty
yes.
much the same.
Mm-hmm.
I assume there's some options to do some styling if you wanted to do
mm-hmm.
that.
Yeah, so the Sencha Touch framework has flexible styling so that if you want to totally customize your theme per platform, we can dynamically load that theme based upon whether you're on the iPad, on web, on your Windows phone.
Great.
The theming is all done through CSS3, so it's very, very easy to get set up and running.
Okay, cool. And to get started with Sencha Architect, which is clearly, like I said, a little bit better than my notepad for making a Sencha application, just go to Sencha.com and mm-hmm. go from there?
Exactly, yeah. So we have I want to say it's a 30-day free trial,
okay,
after
great.
Which you can buy your license if you like it.
Okay.
But as I said, you don't have to use Sencha Architect. If it's if it's just one more tool in your toolbox and you are someone has to pry the IDE out of your cold, dead hands,
right.
Then that's totally fine. So you can write all your code by hand. It's to your choice.
Great. And just to reiterate one more time, I don't know if you want to go back one tab, but all the tutorials to kind of set up your application with Sencha and walk through different areas of mobile services are right on the Windows Azure documentation for mobile services. If you go into the mobile services site, you'll see that as an option for all the tutorials, which is great. It's really great to have that surface there, so it's easy to see and easy
mm-hmm.
to find.
Yeah.
Great. All right, well, thanks so much for coming out today. We really appreciate you talking to us about what you can do with Sencha and Windows mm-hmm. Azure.
Thanks
I think
for having
the people
me.
That watch are going to be really excited. Thanks for everybody for watching. Make sure you follow the Cloud Cover Show on Twitter as well as on Facebook. Do you have a Facebook handle in case people want to reach out to you?
I can give you my Twitter handle, which is Arthur AK.
All right. Well, we'll make sure the editor puts it out there for us. So thanks everybody for watching and have a great day.
Thank you.